Welcome to the viewers for the lecture on structural analysis. Now we are discussing the topic cables and suspension bridges. From lecture number 71 to 74 that we have discussed so far, we have discussed how to analyze cables without stiffening girder. We know in the case of suspension bridges, the cables are the main load bearing members, and the cable is going to carry the entire load, and the cable is flexible throughout. So far the problems that we have discussed are cables without stiffening girder, right? When there is a point load, the cable will become into two straight pieces. When there are two point loads, it will just straighten and become into three straight pieces depending upon the load, right? So cable is the main load bearing member, and the cable is flexible throughout the span. And what we are going to discuss from now onwards is cables with the stiffening girder, because the cable will not be subjected to UDL over the entire span, because in a lengthy bridge of 500 meters or 1 kilometer or 1.5 kilometers, loads will be here and there. Therefore, the cable, allowing the cable to change the shape also is not advisable. So we have to maintain the shape of the cable. The cable will, under uniformly distributed load, the cable will maintain parabolic shape, right? So for which we are going to provide stiffening girders. Stiffening girders are of two types. One is 3-inch stiffening girder like this. So this is a cable stiffened by a 3-inch stiffener. So 2 hinges at the ends and 1 hinge at the center. 3-inch. The other one is that of a 2-inch stiffening girder, right? Now the stiffening girders are suspended from the cable, because the stiffening girder, as it is, for a very long span, the 3-inch stiffening girder cannot stand. So it is actually suspended from the cable, right? It is suspended from the cable, right? Now, by providing the stiffening girder, the function of the stiffening girder is to convert the live load, whatever may be the live load, maybe 2 point loads or 3 point loads or UDL partly over the span. The function of the stiffening girder is to convert the live load as uniformly distributed load, and that load will be transferred to the cable as UDL. Therefore, when the live load is converted as a uniformly distributed load and transmitted to the cable, whatever may be the load on the deck slab, the cable will be subjected to UDL. When the cable is subjected to UDL, the shape, the parabolic shape of the cable will be maintained, and thereby the deck slab will be fairly level, right? And now the live load will be causing bending moment and shear force in the stiffening girder. Dead load, whatever may be the dead load will be directly transmitted to the cable, because the stiffening girder will convert the load as UDL, and this UDL, because this itself is suspended from the cable, so the load will be transmitted to the cable. Let us say that this cable, the stiffening girder is subjected to some 2 point loads, one load here, say another load somewhere here, point loads W1 and W2. These are the live loads. Now we are not going to discuss about dead loads, but the thing that is to be remembered is the dead load will be directly transmitted to the cable. Dead load will not cause bending moment or shear force in the stiffening girder, right? Only live load will cause bending moment and shear force in the girder, and that too when it is transferred to, because now here we have taken only 2 loads only. We have not touched anything about the dead load. We have applied only 2 point loads. 2 point loads. So this will cause UDL in the cable. And that UDL in turn will cause a horizontal thrust, a vertical reaction, all these things are only due to W1 and W2 shown, right? W2 shown. So that is about, so the parabolic shape of the cable will be maintained. Dead load will be entirely taken by the cable. Shear force and bending moment only due to live load. Dead load will not cause any bending moment or shear force. So this is only due to the live load, right? And the cable will strengthen the girder. The girder, a 3-inch girder on its own will not stand for long span bridges. Actually, it is suspended, as I told earlier, it is suspended from the cable. So that causes tension. The weight of the stiffening girder will cause a tension. So this cable, the cable will cause tension. So this will be under tension. This will be this stiffeners or suspenders. So this will be under tension. So the cable will be under tension. So this will cause uniform tension in the suspension cable. So all these things are only due to the W1 and W2 shown in the figure. No other load, right? So this will cause a uniformly distributed load P per unit length. P per unit length. And that will cause horizontal tension, right? So this is the function. Now the point to be remembered is that the cable strengthens the stiffening girder. As it is, it cannot withstand. The cable strengthens the stiffening girder. The stiffening girder, because of these two point loads, it will cause UDL. This UDL is only due to these two loads. So this is the uniformly distributed load. That will cause a horizontal tension. Horizontal tension. So the stiffening girder stiffens the cable. This strengthens the girder. The cable strengthens the girder. The stiffening girder stiffens the cable. That is, the suspension cable and the stiffening girder complement each other. Right. Now, with this introduction, we'll take up a numerical example. So, but very strong in the basics, that is, dead load will not cause any bending moment or shear force in the girder. Dead load will be directly transmitted to the cable. Live load alone will cause bending moment shear force in the stiffening girder. Now we'll take up a problem only due to live load, and other cases we'll discuss subsequently. Now before going to the numerical example, I want to thank the viewers. Thank you, dear viewers and subscribers. It gives me a lot of. I have started and doing this as a service, but still there are a lot of people, faculty members and student from all over. I got a lot of encouragement. So thank you, viewers and subscribers. So this I wanted to do it today. Right. Now we'll take up a numerical example. Right. Now I'll read the problem, because it is a lengthy problem, it cannot be written now. I'll read the problem, thereby we'll just note down the data then and there, and then solve the problem. Right. Actually, this problem is given as an exercise problem in the book that I have mentioned in the last lecture, Structural Analysis 2 by Dr. Vaidyanathan sir and myself. So in that book, at the end of the topic on cables and suspension bridges, it is given as an exercise problem. So I will read the problem parallelly, note down the data, so that the viewers, when they refer some problem in the form of text, you will be aware how to take the data, how to mark the data systematically, and then how to solve the problem. So that idea you will get. Therefore, I will just read the problem and write the data. The three-hinged stiffening girder is shown with hinges at the ends and at the midspan. Generally, it will be given as midspan. Sometimes, when the cable is supported different levels, it may not be at the center. Of course, that we can solve, but it will not be always at the center. When the supports are at different levels, then it will not be at the center. Right? Stiffening girder of a suspension bridge of span 200 meters. So, span of the bridge is 200 meters. He is subjected to two point loads of 450 kilonewton and 280 kilonewtons at distances of 40 meters and 150 meters respectively from the left end. There is one load, let us say this load W1, this is 450 kilonewton. This load is 450 kilonewton. This load is at a distance of 40 meters. First load. Second load, 40 meters. Second load is 280 kilonewton here. This load is at a distance of 150 meters from the left end. Right. These are the two loads, 450 and 280 at distances of 40 and 150 meters from the left end. That's about the loading. Right. Find the shear force and bending moment in the girder. Shear force bending on the girder at a section 75 meters from the left end. So let us call this point as, we will call this point as G. This distance is 75 meters. So what is required is, what is the shear force at G? Shear force you can use F or you can use S. Shear force SG is required. Bending moment at G is required. So that is the first part. First part is that of find the bending moment, a shear force and bending moment in the girder at a section 75 meters from the left hand support. 75 meters. Right. Then find the bending moment under the point loads also. We will give some numbering. This is A, B. The lowest point we call it as C. Now here we'll call this point as E. We'll call this point as F. We have used G. We'll use H for the first load, H, and L for the second load. So also you'll have to find out the bending moment under the loads. Under the load means you have to find out the bending moment at H. MH is required and ML is also required. ML is also bending moment under the loads. Find the bending moments under the point loads also. That is MH and ML. The central dip of the cable is 16 meters. So it is given that D equal to the central dip d equal to 16 meters. 16 meters. Find also the maximum tension in the cable. Find also the maximum tension in the cable. And draw the bending moment diagram for the girder. Draw the bending moment diagram for the girder. So these are the requirements. So that's about the problem. Now, before starting this problem, next lecture will be on influence line. This problem we are going to do it analytically. The same problem will be discussed. I will not do the problem, but it will be discussed. It will be discussed so that you will have to remember these values. There you will find it more convenient. Right? After which I will do full problem, that is different. In the discussion, I will involve this problem here and there. So better remember what is the span, what is the dip, what are the loads, where they are applied, all these things, so that we have some relation between this lecture and the next lecture. So that I want to, so that you will be a little more attentive for this. Right. Now coming to this problem, first we have to find out the reaction in the stiffening girder. In the stiffening girder, we will find out the value of the VE and VF. VF equal to, right, VE and VF. Taking moments about F, VE into 450 on VE into 200, sorry. VE into 200 is a span minus, there are two loads. One is 450, we are taking moment about F, therefore the distance equal to 200 minus 40 equal to 160 minus, there is another load 280, 150 meters from the left end or 50 meters from the right end, 280 into 50 equal to 0. These are the loads. Because when you take moment about B, we have two horizontal thrust, one here, that will get cancelled, and we are considering the total structure. So VE into 50, VE into 200 minus 450 into 160 minus 280 into 50 equal to 0. That's all. Equal to 0. So that will give you 200 VE equal to 86,000. Therefore, VE equal to 430 kilonewtons. 30 kilonewtons. Right. So, VF equal to total load minus VE. Total load is 450 plus 280. There are two loads. 450 plus 280 will be the total load, minus VE equal to 430. 430, that will give you VF equal to 300 kilonewton. So VE equal to 430, and this is equal to 300 kilonewtons. Right. Then we have to find out the value of horizontal tension. We will take moment about the lowest point in the cable. We will consider, with respect to C, we will consider all the forces to the left of the section or all the forces to the right of the section. Considering all the forces, either to the left alone or to the right alone. Now let us consider the forces to the left. When we consider the forces to the left, moment at C, MC equal to VE into 100, VE into 100 minus 450 into 60 minus H into D. D is 16 equal to 0. So this is equal to VE is 430 into 100 minus 450 into 60 minus H into 16 equal to 0. Or H will be equal to, on solving, H will be equal to 1000 kilonewtons. And for this, there is a formula also, that is, H will be mu C by D. So this formula you can use. H is equal to mu C by D. Mu C is a bending moment as a simply supported beam. As a simply supported beam, mu C equal to VE into 100 minus 450 into 60. That is what is the numerator. So forget about this. Equal to H into D. Therefore, H equal to this value by D. So that also can be done. It is mu C by D. So mu C equal to VE into 100 minus 450 into 60 about the point C. By D equal to 16. That will give you the horizontal tension. So either we can do it like this, or considering the force to the right hand side, we can try like this, or we can directly use the formula. So that formula should not be a constraint, right? Therefore, H equal to 1000 kilonewtons. H is equal to 1000 kilonewtons. So that's about the reactions, right? Now, next we will find out the required values one by one. Let us start with the bending moment at G, mg. Bending moment at G, or you can say mg, or bmg, or mg, or bending moment at G. Right. So, bending moment at this point. We just will find out the bending moment at this point, which is at distance of 75 meters from the left hand support. Right. So, bending moment mg equal to mu x minus h into y. Mu is the bending moment as a simply supported beam. This horizontal tension will cause a reduction in the bending moment in the stiffening girder. Like that, in the case of arches, the horizontal thrust causes the reduction in the bending moment. Mu x minus h, same formula, mu x minus h into y. So here the horizontal tension will cause a reduction, so that we will have to calculate. H into y will have to calculate. So mu x will be it is VE into 75. We are finding out the bending moment at 75 meter for the left hand support. So VE into 75. Now there is a load at H, so that will cause, so minus the load is 450 into distance is 35, because this is 75, this is 40, therefore this value will be 35. So minus H is 1000. Into y at the point G, that you have to find out. So y at the point G, or D at the point G, equal to 4D by L square X into L minus X, equal to 4 into central dip is 16 by 200 square, L is 200, X is 75 for the point G, X is 75, this is 200 minus 75. So this will give you the value of Y at the point G. the value of y at the point G is 15 meters. Therefore, mg equal V is 430 into 75 minus 450 into 35 minus 1000 into 15 will give mg equal to 1500 kilonewton meter. This is the first value, mg. We have got it, one value, right? Right. Next is the shear force at G. Shear force at G. Now, shear force at any section is given by shear force as a beam minus h tan theta. The effect due to the horizontal tension. The beam shear, SB is the beam SB equal to at the point G. Before this we have got one vertical reaction, one downward load. These are the two loads. Vertical as a beam, the beam shear equal to VE minus 450. VE equal to 430 minus 450 equal to minus 20 kilonewton. Minus 20 kilonewton. That is first part. Second part, H tan theta. H into tan theta. That is, when this is the cable, part of the cable up to the point G. Up to the point. So this is point A, this is point G. Right. Point G. Now, here you will have the tension along the direction of the cable. So it is continuous. So this is the tension in the cable. Right. Now, this angle with the horizontal is theta. This value is theta. Right. Now, the vertical component of this is V. V. And the horizontal component of this is H. Right. Now, this is also theta. This is also, when this is theta, this is also theta. Right. Now, this vertical component, this value will cause a reduction in the shear. Right. Now, to find out the value of V, you know, V by H equal to tan theta. V by H equal to tan theta, or V equal to H tan theta. So this force, now here it is downwards. So now that will have to subtract H tan. That is why it is beam shear minus H tan theta. Minus H tan theta. So H tan theta equal to H into tan theta equal to 4D by L square. 4D by L square into L minus 2x. We know y equal to 4d by l square into x into l minus x. So differentiating, dy by dx will be 4d by l square into l minus 2x. That is, when x is taken inside, that will become lx and x square on differentiation. So dy by dx equal to tan theta. This already is familiar in the topic on arches. So h into this value. So this we'll have to calculate. So it is H equal to 1000 into 4D by L square. 4D is 16, 200 square into L is 200 minus 2 into 75. 2 into 70, because we are calculating the shear force at the point G, whose x value equal to 75. So 2 into 75. So this will be equal to 1000 into 0.08, equal to 1000 into 0.08. So this value equal to 0.08. On calculation, that is equal to 0.08. Therefore, coming to this equation, equal to SB equal to minus 20, minus H into tan theta is 1000 into 0.08. So that is equal to, that value equal to minus 100 kilonewton. This is the shear force at G. Shear force at G equal to minus 100 kilonewtons. So that completes the shear force calculation for the point G. Next is the bending moment at H, MH. MH, hereafter same procedure we are going to follow. MH equal to same mu x minus H into y. So mu x is the bending moment as a simply supported beam. Up to the point H there is no other load, only at H there is a load. We have one reaction and one load as a beam. Then H into that value you have to calculate. So mu x equal to V e into 40. That's all. V e into 40 minus H into Y at the point H. Y at the point H. So this is equal to V e is 430 into 40 minus H is 1000 into YH equal to 4D by, this we can calculate separately, 4D by L square X into L minus X. So this is 4 into D is 16, L is 200 square, X is 40, for the point H it is 40, L is 200 minus 40. So this will be equal to for the point H, for the point H, the value equal to 10.24 meters. Therefore, into 10.24, this will give you the value of MH. Actually, we could have used K, no problem. This better, you can use the value K here, because already we used H for the horizontal tension, so better to use K in the place of H, right? Otherwise we will proceed. Now when you can differentiate this H and this H, time being it is okay, but it is better to change this point as K instead of H, right? Now we will proceed as H only, no problem, right? MH equal to 6960 kilonewton meter. So this is MH. So this is over. Next is ML. For getting the value of ML, same procedure. I'll rub off and rewrite it. it is better. ML equal to ML equal to mu x minus h into y. So mu x here, instead of considering VE, this load and this load, we will come from the right hand side. So coming from the right hand side, it is VF into 50. VF into 50. So this distance is 50 meters. This distance is 50 meters. We are calculating the value here at the point L, which is 50 meters for right hand side. There is no other load between L and F. So minus H into Y. Minus H into Y at the point L. Right. So VF is 300 into 50 minus H is 1000, and YL will be YL equal to 4D by L square X into L minus X equal to 4D is 16 by 200 square X is measured from the right. X is 50, L minus X is 200 minus 50, no problem. 200 minus. Both will give the same value. Even if we take x as 150, this will become 150. L minus x will become 50. No problem. Right. So this is equal to 12 meters. This value equal to 12 meters because it is a quarter span point. In the case of parabolic shape of cable or parabolic shape of arch, the dip at the quarter span point is 3/4 of the central dip. So 3/4 of 16 equal to 12 meters. Now when you calculate, you will get the value to be 12 meters. So 1000 into 12 meters. So that you can use as a check, but we cannot directly write at the quarter span point dip equal to 3/4 of the central dip. That we cannot write. We can use it for checking whether our answer is correct or not. So this will give you ML equal to 3000 kilonewton meter. 3000 kilonewton meter. So this is over. ML is also over. Next we have to find out the value of T max. Now, we have to take a moment about this point here. We know H equal to, we know when it is subjected to UDL, we know, and when the cables are support the same level, when the supports are at the same level, when it is subjected to UDL, we know H equal to P L square by 8D. H equal to P L square by 8D. Therefore, P equal to 8D H by L square. Retaining this alone on the right hand side, taking all other terms to the left hand side. Therefore, P equal to 8 into D is 16, H equal to 1000 divided by 200 square. Now that will be equal to 3.2 kilonewton per meter. Once you find out the value of P, then the reaction, so this value we have got it just now. So all these things are only due to the two point loads given. There is no other load. So now we will have to find out the value of VA and VB. VA equal to VB equal to PL by 2. PL by 2, P is 3.2, L is 200 by 2. That is equal to, this will become 100. So 3.2 into 100 equal to 320 kilonewton per meter. 320 kilonewton per meter. So V equal to 320. So once if we get the value of horizontal tension and the vertical reaction equal to 320 kilonewton. Therefore, T max equal to root of V square plus H square. V is 320 equal to 320 square plus 1000 square. That will be equal to 1049.95. So this is T max. So T max also we have got it. Right. Now we have completed all the requirements excepting the bending moment diagram. Now we know the bending moment any section Mx equal to, I'll just give you only the hints. You have to try the problem and any book will give the bending moment diagram. Now the bending moment at any section equal to mu x minus h into y. This is a well-known equation, right? Now mu x is a bending moment as a simply supported beam. Now you got a beam subjected to one point load here and another point load here. For that you can draw the bending moment diagram. That is a bending moment diagram as a simply supported beam. When a simply supported beam is subjected to constant loads, you can find out the, so you can write down the equation for Mx for this. Substitute x equal to 0, x equal to 40. Write down the equation for this. Substitute x equal to 40 and x equal to 150. Write down the equation for Mx. So that will give you whether it is linear or second degree. The governing equation will tell you whether the curve is linear or second degree. Suppose if there is any point where it changes sign, all those things will be indicated by the equation. It's not a new thing. Only thing is you have to remember that it consists of the bending moment as a simply supported beam minus the horizontal thrust into y. Now y will be consisting of 4d by l square x into l minus x. So when you multiply this inside, you will get x will be of power 2. So that will be a second degree curve. So this diagram minus h into y will give the, so you have to superimpose the two diagrams. One is you draw the simplest of bending moment diagram as a simply support beam, then write down the equation for h into y, substitute different values of x, you will get the bending moment due to the reduction due to the horizontal thrust. Reduction of bending moment due to the horizontal tension. So superimposing the two diagrams, cancelling out the common terms, you will get the bending moment diagram. So this, I expect the viewers to do some work on this, try to get the bending moment diagram, compare with the bending moment diagram available in some book. Now I got some more points to discuss. One is, we have discussed about the shear force. We have discussed about the shear force. The shear force at the point G. Now suppose if the shear force at the point L is required, let us say the shear force at the point L is required means again it is beam shear minus H tan theta as before, same equation, beam shear minus H tan theta. So for this L we have only VF on the right hand side. So beam shear is only minus VF because right up is negative. Coming to shear, we have to follow the sign convention. So minus VF. There is no other load. Minus H tan theta. We know tan theta is 4D by L square into L minus 2x. Now, it is 4 into D is 16 by L square is 200 square, L is 200, x when it is measured from the left hand support, x when it is measured from the left hand support, 2 into 150. So this on calculations, this is 200, this is 300, will be getting a negative sign, minus. The value within the bracket will become negative. Therefore, it is minus h, we can say minus h, minus this value. This is also minus of this value. Sometimes it will be given in the book as plus h tan theta. Formula is minus only because this tan theta term is negative. Therefore, minus into minus plus. Either in the substitution or sometimes in the formula itself, it will be given as plus. Therefore, it is because of this minus sign. So, the viewers need not get confused when you happen to see the formula as minus h minus sb plus h tan theta. Normally it will not be given, but if it is given, you have to understand it is because of the tan theta, because for x more than L by 2, this value will be negative. Therefore, either you can substitute the value here as negative or minus to minus plus negative. So that is one confusion that is supposed to be avoided when you are asked to find out the shear force at a section beyond the mid-span, when x is more than L by 2, this sign problem will be there. That is one problem. Second point I want to discuss is, here we have given two point loads only. We have taken only one set of girder. Now, they may give a bridge of some 700 meter span. Let us say the width of the bridge is 16 meters. They will give you, it is subjected to a live load of 10 kilonewton per square meter, a dead load of 12 kilonewton per square meter. So if that is the problem, if a problem like this, giving the length of the bridge, width of the bridge, live load and dead load per square meter, if it is given like this, you need not get confused. What you do is, first point to be remembered is, here you will have a cable and stiffening girder on this side. You will have another set of cable and stiffening girder on this side. So one on either side. What is shown is only on one side. What is shown is only one set of cable and stiffening girder. So similarly, you will have one on either side of the width of the bridge. Therefore, you have to understand that this is cable number one, this is cable number two as shown. That is to be remembered. Right. Now, how to calculate the load? Right. Now, consider 1 meter length of the bridge. So in 1 meter, live load is 10 kilonewton per square meter. That is acting over an area of 1 meter by 16 meters. 1 meter by 16 meters is a total load. Total load acting on 1 meter length of the bridge is 10 into 1 into 16. That is shared by two cables. One on this side, one on this side. So by 2. This will give you the live load per meter. Live load, so many kilonewton per meter. I think this we can do because 8. This is 80 kilonewton per meter. It is subjected to UDL of 80 kilonewton. UDL like this. UDL, we'll have to mark UDL. Right. Whatever is the length that is given, we'll have to mark UDL. So UDL may be given over the full span or part of the live load. Live load may be acting over the entire span. Live load may be acting over part of the span. Right. Dead load will be acting over the entire span. Now coming to dead load equal to 12 kilonewton per square meter, this is intensity, into 1 meter length into 16 meters width, that is shared by two cables, one cable on this side, another cable on this side by 2. So that is equal to this will be equal to 96 kilonewtons per meter. So that is the UDL that you'll have to consider here. So it is acting in the form of UDL. It will be given whether the live load is acting over only half of the span or one third of span. Location will be given. That you'll have to treat separately. When live load and dead load are given, as I told earlier, don't bother about the dead load till the end. Only when you find out the tension in the cable, because dead load will be directly taken by the cable. So you have to calculate the bending moment, live load, bending moment, the shear force in the girder only due to the live load, right? So that you have to. So you have to deal with live load, dead load separately. The uniformly distributed load due to live load you will have to calculate separately. The UDL due to dead load you will have to calculate separately. This is at the end only. So adding these two, you will get the P per unit length. So therefore, when uniform distributed load is given, you can solve the problem. And loads like this is given, then also you need not worry. This is one type of problem. One more type of problem is the, now here we have given, they have given 450 and 280. Sometimes they will give, it is subjected to some 3 or 4 point loads of some 50 kilonewton each. 50 at 10 meters, 20 meters, 30 meters, 40 meters, like that. So in that case, when you take the Stefani girder, this is applied at the center. So 25 here and 25 here, 25 here, 25 here. So at the stated distances, you have to take 25 as the point. So that will be shared by 2 cables. So 25 and 25, this you'll have to mark and do the problem. So if it is given along the center of the width of the bridge like that, divide by 2, and one cable will take half the load, and that you'll have to take, and for that you'll have to solve the problem, and for this you'll have to find out the bending moment and shear force in the stiffening girder. I think that's about cables with 3-inch stiffening girder. With this introduction, you can solve any problem analytically, that is for cables, with a stiffening girder, with a 3-inch stiffening girder. For any type of problem, this introduction will be one problem we have done fully, it has been introduced, and other types of problems discussed. I hope this introduction will be more than sufficient for solving any type of problem, right? Thank you.